So does this law has anything for men? Is it against men or does it favor the other gender? What is it?
You know, the very interesting part about this law, it has only defined the gender of the victim or the complainant, okay, which is woman. So that's why you will see that prevention of sexual harassment of women at workplace, right? Nowhere in this law it has said that prevention of sexual harassment of women from men at workplace. It's just that we are living in a society wherein from generations of experience, we have conditioned our brain, or our brain has been conditioned to think that every time there is anything which is being done to harm women, it must be coming from men. And every time we are talking about protecting women, we have to protect them from men. So this is one thing that we all need to understand, that this law is introduced to provide safety for women, but it is not putting men in the bad light. It's just something that we have accepted as a part of our social conditioning. Having said that, yes, one thing is there. This law does not provide any protection for men from any form of sexual harassment at workplaces. Men are not covered. But at the same time, it is not preventing, or it has not restricted anyone from including them. A lot of organizations that I'm working with, and even otherwise, there is this trend that has been growing that they are accepting this law in their policies and internally in their processes for all genders. They have made it an inclusive policy, and the protection that they are providing under, you know, from sexual harassment at workplace instances is equal to all the genders who are operating in that workspaces, and the law is not restricting that. So yes, on one hand, we can say that the lawmakers only introduced it for one gender. When it comes to operational applicability or adaptability of this, no one is stopping workplaces from making it gender neutral. Yes, to look at it from an angle that are men getting harmed from it? See, this is once again social conditioning coming into picture, wherein having this law in place also is actually resulting into people deciding that we do not want to have women in our teams, because if we don't have any women, there will be no misunderstandings, there will be no conflict in intent and perceptions, less complications, no instances of sexual harassment, and we can all work in peace. So yes, the law, I don't know if it is harming men or not, but it is definitely harming women in that manner. Having said that, I think to a certain extent, yes, we have also started seeing instances of false accusations. I will not really say how high or low they are, but definitely, if I give you a tool, there will be individuals who will figure out a way to use it in a productive manner, in a positive manner, and there will be individuals who will end up using it in a non-productive or a negative manner. That is completely up to human nature. We cannot really do anything about it. But within the law itself, there is a beautiful mechanism of reverse investigation in the instances of false accusations. What does it mean? It simply means that if ever an instance of sexual harassment complaint is found to be a frivolous or as a malicious false complaint from the woman's side, and during the investigation or after the investigation, if it is found that it is a false matter, then the internal complaints committee can actually start a reverse investigation on the complainant, on the woman complainant, and whatever consequences would have been applicable for the accused if the matter was to be proven, whatever consequences were to be levied on the man if the matter was proven true, now in the instance of a false accusation from the woman as a complainant, the same consequences will be applicable on that woman, because she had a malicious intent in her mind when she was filing this false complaint. So directly we can say that this law does not favor men, but we also need to see that it has taken care. See, it has taken care that it is not used against men. But all these things needs to be told to people. Until now, on the face value, we only know that now that this law is out there, and as soon as an organization adopts this law, the minute a woman decides that there's an instance of sexual harassment, she can just approach the internal complaints committee and an action will be taken. Either the man will be fired, or he will be demoted, or he will be asked to leave, or there will be a fine on that person, and that would be it, and his side will not be heard. And earlier, in one of the questions that we were looking into the way how internal complaints committee will be handling the investigations, I specifically mentioned that a thorough investigation has a critical element of natural justice, which means that both parties will be given equal and fair opportunity to present their side of the story. They will have fair chance to produce evidences, witnesses to clear out their end of the story, and only then an investigation will conclude. And until that happens, it will not be a fair investigation, and the man will always have the right to actually challenge the decision of the internal complaints committee and take the matter forward either to the management or directly to the court. And that is why it is very important for men out there to understand that having this law in place is not really there to harm them or to damage their reputation in the workplaces, but instead it is there to create, it has taken enough measures to ensure that the misuse and abuse of this law does not happen. But it all depends on how well the organization internally adopts these mechanisms. Having an ICC in place, training them, equipping them with the right skills and knowledge to adhere to the guidelines mentioned under this law is extremely crucial for everyone's benefit, for all the genders involved in workplaces.